clicked this video, it's probably because one, you're looking to cause chaos and destruction on your desk. Two, you just got your mini skiddy kit and you're looking to build it. Or three, you want to compete in the Flip Cup Challenge, which consists of flipping this cup over in as little time as possible with your mini skiddy. The top contestants will be awarded the Skiddy Certified role on the Professor Boots Discord server. So if any of this is of interest to you, make sure to keep on watching so that you can build your very own mini skiddy. All the designs and wiring diagrams are open source, so if you feel like just sourcing all the components yourself, that is definitely an option. To kick this project off right, I'm just going to be using one of my complete kits, which you can pick up through the link in the description below. There's also just the electronics version that doesn't have any of the 3D printed parts for all you 3D printing enthusiasts out there. But with that, let's go ahead and jump right into building this little guy.
Look at it, it's so cute.
The only thing that doesn't come in this kit is a battery and charger, and I personally like to use these 300 milliamp Tattoo 7.4 volt LiPo batteries. They come in a pack of four, and you just want to make sure that they have this XT30 connector on. The tools required for assembly are pretty simple. A small flathead screwdriver, about a medium-sized Phillips screwdriver, and then just a pair of really basic cutters slash pliers. And this is just to peel out any support material that's going to be left over on the 3D printed parts. So with that, let's go ahead and unbox everything in here, and we'll get this show on the road. So laid out in front of me is everything we need to build a mini skiddy. The first thing I'm gonna go ahead and do is take our white PLA parts and just go through and separate them all. You can see how they're connected via these little supports. I'm just gonna go ahead and take our cutters and cut them all apart, kind of just like a model kit. Now that we have all the supports that we're connecting all the individual pieces together, it's time to go back through and actually clear out the supports that are on the individual piece. So, for example, on this wheel, you can see that there's this little circle cut out in the middle. This is actually support for the inside where the axle is going to go. So taking your pliers, you're just going to want to go ahead and push down on that, and you'll see it cave in really easily. And then you're just going to pry it up. Just like that. Do your best to make sure that the inside of this is flat. It's never going to be perfect, but this is where the axle is going to sit, and so we want it to be as flat as possible so the wheel doesn't wobble at all. Another example is on the arms. There's going to be this other little circle support right here. You're just going to take your pliers, push down on it, and kind of wiggle it loose, just like that. On the main housing, for each of these holes where the axles go, you're just going to pop out the support material in between, as well as on the arm slots where the arms are going to pop in, you're just going to push out that material. Once you have the material out of the axle holes, it's a really good idea to just go around and scrape away any excess that might be on there, because when we go to put in our axles, it's going to be really tough to get them through if there's even just a little bit of remnants of that support. Now finally, on the main housing, under this PCB support, which is going to be really hard to see, you'll see a little tower of support that runs up under that. I'm just gonna take my flathead screwdriver and just pop it under that support and pop it out. Our bucket, so using our flathead screwdriver, I'm just gonna pop it under the support and just kind of. And with that, we should be done cleaning up our white PLA parts, so we can go ahead and push these to the side, and now we're gonna work on our black PLA parts. Black PLA parts are gonna consist of the driver cage, our motor cover, and then our motor supports, which are going to be in this little bag with our motor gears. But these don't actually need cleaning up, so we can just ignore those for the moment. Starting with our driver cage, what I like to do is take a small flathead screwdriver, and for each of these little holes, I'm just going to go through and pop out the support. Our driver cage done, I'm going to move on to the motor cover, and this one's super easy. The only thing you really got to clean up is this little overhang right here. Moving on to our tires and drive belts, these ones are pretty easy to clean up. You just want to look inside and make sure there isn't any rubber stringing going on. As you can see, there's a little bit with this guy, so just kind of go through and pull out any of that excess material. Your belts, and you just want to make sure that there isn't any blockages, or like you can kind of see here, or maybe not, but there's just a little bit of extra filament that kind of got extruded right there, so I'm just going to go through and snip that out. We want to make sure that these are as close to perfect as we can get, because these are actually what connect our front and rear tires together, so these need to be running really smoothly in order for that to work efficiently. For those of you who are printing parts at home, I'm using Sane Smart TPU, which is about the only TPU that I can guarantee will work with these belts. I've had a couple people reach out to me that have printed their own parts with other brands of TPU, and it seems like there's a couple issues out there. SaneSmart TPU is a bit more sturdy than other ones, and so it doesn't really allow for a lot of flex. But yeah, just keep that in mind as you're printing your TPU belts. Finally, if you're adding the claw attachment, or if you ordered the kit, you'll already have the claw attachment, but you're just gonna go ahead and peel this away from the raft that it was printed on. And then you're just gonna take it and remove any support material. You know the drill. I see that there's a little bit of stringing on this corner right here, so I'm just gonna take some pliers and cut it away. Push rod arm for the claw, just gently peel that away from the raft as well, and set that to the side. For the drive shafts, there's not really any excess support material, but they are printed on a raft. You can go ahead and peel those off. Now that we have all our parts cleaned up, it's time for the fun part, which is actually putting things together. So starting with our main housing, wrap one of the flat face drive axles with a TPU belt and slide it through the axle hole in the front left of the main housing. Secure it in place with a small C-clip. Then repeat this process for the rear right axle hole. In efforts to make this not an hour-long tutorial, I'll try and keep the steps as concise as possible for both of our sanities. Using an N20 motor with a drive axle and long wires attached, go ahead and tension it with the TPU belt and insert it into the front right drive axle hole. Then make sure it sits nicely in the motor supports. Repeat this process for the left side drive belt, making sure that if it doesn't go in right away, to pull it back out and clear any debris or material that might be stuck inside the drive axle hole. Lock the two N20 motors down in place using either the two separate motor restraints if you're using your own style of battery, or as I'm using here, the motor restraint that has a built-in slot for the 300 milliamp Tattoo LiPo battery. Secure in place using four 2x6 millimeter screws. Using an N20 motor with a pinion gear installed, secure the motor restraint with a short 2x6 millimeter screw on top and a longer 2x8 millimeter screw on the side. Lay the circuit board assembly down flat on the front of the main housing. Then route the left and right motor wires into their respective terminal blocks. For correct motor orientation, I like to route the negative wire or black wire to the bottom of the terminal block and the red wire to the top of the terminal block. Before securing the arm motor wires, I like to first take the H bridges and put them into place. Real quick, I want to talk about the electrical components that go into making the mini skiddy. This is an ESP32 development board, which is a Wi-Fi enabled microcontroller. It's perfect for this project because it lets you access the mini skiddy controller from any device that can use a web browser. For example, your phone, laptop, crusty old middle school Nintendo DS, whatever it may be, as long as it can use a web browser, chances are you can probably drive the mini skiddy. If you're wondering what happened to the Dabble app that I used previously, I ended up kicking that one to the curb, mainly because I kept getting a bunch of notifications about people not being able to download it specifically on Android device. So for that, I apologize, but this new method, in my opinion, is a way better controller. It has a way better feel, it's funner to use, and it's just way more accessible. Next is our DRV8833H bridge. This allows us to pull current directly from the battery rather than pulling it from the ESP32 pins, which would result in a very sad and dead ESP32. Our N20 motors can pull quite a bit of current if they're under full stall conditions, which would really not sit well with the ESP32 pins. So this allows us to circumnavigate that, and it also allows us to flip the direction forward or backward of the motors. So these are super handy, and this is what we'll be using today in our mini skiddy. Finally, I have this 5-volt buck converter. Well, I say 5 volts, but that's just what I have it set to. You could actually set it to any of it. So you could set it to 1.8 volts, you could set it to 12 volts, depending on what your incoming voltage is. As long as your incoming voltage is higher, you can usually drop it down with this. So for example, in this project, where did I put my battery? In this project, we're using the 7.4 volt, 300 milliamp Tattoo LiPo battery. Now, 7.4 volts is the key thing to take away there. The servos that we're using are rated at about 6 volts. Anything more can cause some damage, as well as the N20 motors that we're using, which are also rated about 6 volts. So we really want to make sure we're either right at that or below it, so that our motors and servos last as long as they possibly can. That's where this little guy comes in. It takes the 7.4 volts coming in and spits out 5 volts. A quick note if you've sourced all these components yourself is to one, make sure to solder the two 5-volt pads together, and then you're gonna wanna go ahead and cut this trace right here. This eliminates the variable resistor from the circuit, ensuring that we have a steady 5 volts. I also recommend having a meter on hand to check this, just so you can be sure it's 5 volts that's coming out. Though if you ordered the electrical kit through me, you can rest easy knowing that there's already a steady 5 volts coming out and that it's been pre-tested. If you want more details on the electronics and soldering the circuit board together, make sure to check out the Instructables guide linked below. Before securing the arm motor wires, I like to first take the H bridges and put them into place. Make sure they're in the correct orientation as shown here, or if you really want to be sure, make sure that the EE pin on the H bridge lines up with the EE pin on the circuit board assembly. Secure the arm motor wires in the top blue terminal block as shown here. Press the circuit board down into the bottom right circuit board support, and then secure the top left corner with a short 2x6mm screw. We now have the N20 motors fully installed and we can move on to wheel assembly. Start by pressing the wheel into each side of the tire. There'll be one side where the wheel sits in just a little bit further. This is so there's a lip when the tire is fully on. If you're having troubles pressing the tire directly on, you can also do what I do here and just leverage the little tabs that are on the tire using a flathead screwdriver. This makes it a little bit easier to slide the tire on. Repeat this for all four tires. Take each wheel and tire set and place it onto the axle. Wiggle it back and forth a little to make sure it's fully seated, and then secure in place using a medium-sized 2x8mm screw. Repeat this process for the three other wheel and tire sets. Adding the wheel wells is a simple task by just securing them in place with a medium-sized 2x8mm screw. Make sure they're above the two nubs that are on the main housing. This just prevents any rotation from happening. Secure an SG90 servo to the bucket using two small 2x6mm screws. Then, using a 2x12mm screw, secure the right arm to the bucket. Make sure that it's just snug enough where it doesn't have any free play from side to side, but can move up and down freely. Secure a servo horn to the left arm using a 2x6mm screw. Route the bucket tilt wire in the right arm through the right arm hole in the main housing. Then, secure in place with a large C-clip. Route the servo connector to pin set 23 and make sure that the brown wire goes to the bottom pin, which is our ground.
At this point, it's time to calibrate our servo so it's in the right position. So in order to do that, we have to populate our other electronics, which means our 5-volt buck converter
and our ESP32 development board. Also, using your battery of choice, connect it and secure it in place.
Now I'm gonna go ahead and flip it on. You're gonna hear the servo move to its initial startup position. Once we have that, we're good to go ahead and turn the mini skiddy back off. Now taking the left arm, and without moving the servo position, we're going to put it directly onto the servo. So you're going to want to make sure that the arm is pretty much all the way up against the bucket, and then you're going to pop the servo horn on to the output gear on the servo. Then using the longer of the servo horn screws, you're going to secure the left arm to the servo.
To lock the left arm in place, press the square end of the large gear outward from the inside of the main housing. Rotate the left arm until you feel it lock in place with the large gear. Then lock the two together with a medium-sized 2x8mm screw.
This is a great time to go and make sure that you're able to connect and make sure everything is going in the right direction. For instance, if one of your motors is going backwards when it should be going forward, this is an easy time to go back through and flip the two motor wires so that it goes in the correct orientation. So to test that, I'm gonna go ahead and flip it on, and then I'm gonna be using just my phone for this test. But basically what you're gonna do is you're gonna go into your settings or however you get to your Wi-Fi connections. I'm gonna go in, and then I'm gonna look for the Professor Boots Mini Skiddy. And this is Mini Skiddy 45. So I'm gonna connect to that just like I would a normal internet connection. And then once it's connected, I'm gonna open up my favorite web browser. And in the search slot, I'm gonna type in 192.168.4.1. And this is just the default IP address of our ESP32, which powers our mini skiddy. So that when we press enter or go, it'll display this nice little controller. It's forward, it moves forward. When I press back, it goes backward. And then this is our arm. Then we have our bucket. Then this auxiliary will be eventually for our claw when we put that on. Up at the top, you're gonna see that there's a horizontal screen checkbox. So if you check that box and then pull down from the top or however you lock your phone into vertical mode. So right now, when I twist it sideways, my phone's not gonna reorientate. And now, what was right is now forward and what was forward is now left. But basically, it just lets you hold your phone in a gamepad orientation and drive the mini skiddy how you normally would. If you're not installing the claw at this time, go ahead and skip forward to where we install the driver cage and motor cover. Otherwise, remove the large sleeve clip that holds the right arm in place and unplug the bucket tilt servo. Lock the SG90 servo into place on the claw using the two smallest 2x6mm pen head screws you can find. Attach the claw assembly to the bucket using two 2x12mm screws. Make sure to not tighten them too much as you want a nice hinge motion. Move the main arm upward, careful not to break any teeth on the arm motor pinion gear, and then tilt the bucket down. Route the wire alongside the other one, being aware that this will take a bit of pressure. Push the servo plug through to the other side, and then back through once more through the pivot point. Route the servo wires on the right arm through the right arm hole in the main housing. Attach the bucket tilt servo to pin set 23 and the claw assembly servo to pin set 22. Make sure that both brown wires are on the bottom, as this is our ground. Don't forget to replace your large arm C-clip. Briefly turn on the mini skiddy to calibrate the claw servo to the correct position. Place the servo horn on the servo exactly how it's shown here. Lock the servo horn in place using one of the longer silver servo horn screws. Take a small 2x6mm screw and place it through the top hole of the claw pushrod. Then place it exactly 3 holes from the center of the servo horn. Connect the pushrod to the bucket using a 2x8mm screw. Make sure that it's not too tight so that it can still move up and down freely. Turn the mini skiddy on, connect to your controller, and make sure you have a full range of movement with the claw. If you don't, try moving the servo horn on the servo, or moving the push rod up or down one hole on the servo horn. All right, our claw is in the perfect position, and one thing I want you to be aware of is that if you first turn it on and one of the servos is making a ton of noise, all you have to do is just loosen these silver screws that secure the servo horn a little bit. For whatever reason, it just seems like if they're a little bit too tight, it kind of binds up the servo a little bit. So if it's making a lot of noise, just thread it out an eighth or so of a turn, and that'll hopefully get rid of your noise. Moving on to the final steps, press the driver cage onto the main housing, making sure to align the two top holes. Then position the motor cover so it sits nicely in between. Lock everything together with two 2x12mm screws, making sure not to over-tighten, as you want to be able to freely pivot the driver cage and motor cover. When securing the motor cover for the first time, it's going to be really stiff, so resist the urge to pull on the wheels, but rather push on the front of the main chassis. This will hopefully save you from snapping a drive shaft. With that, your mini skiddy is officially ready for its first drive, or for turtle test?
It's beautiful. I'd also like to congratulate Andy RC for winning the 1,000 subscriber mini skiddy giveaway, as well as address a very serious question, which is that the last video had over 700 comments recommending all sorts of different projects that should be next. And after a staggering number of requests for a dump truck, I've decided to make that the next project so that we can haul the chaos and destruction caused by our mini skiddy away, because everybody knows having a cleaner desk is actually probably the better way to go. Subscribe and comment down below on your favorite make and model of dump truck, and as always, thank you so much for watching.